All right, welcome today to Memes and Money. What are the facts? Today's webinar is going to be recorded, so feel free to leave if you need to, or if you are concerned about listening again later for new information or sharing, we will email that to anyone that's registered for this event, which we shared the registration URL in the chat. We also will be using the chat a lot today, so hopefully you are familiar with the chat. If not, if you hover over the bottom or top of your screen, there is a black bar that shows up and there is a chat icon you can open up. Let us know that you could hear us okay. And if you have any questions, we have several people monitoring the chat to get you answers or let you know. We can follow up via email or wait till the end of the webinar to ask Nikki or I. So my name is Andrew Pellegrini. I run the Student Money Management Center out of University Bursar for the entire University of Illinois system. So today I'm in Champaign, but in the past I have also traveled to Chicago and Springfield, and I manage financial education activities to reach those students and staff. Nikki, do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. So I am Nikki Giancola-Shanks. I currently work at IDFPR, which stands for the Illinois Department of Financial and Professional Regulation. I am the Director of External Affairs and Student Loan Policy. I work on a lot of our financial education outreach, and I get to work with Andrea a lot.
Thank you so much, Nikki. Nikki's a wealth of knowledge and did a lot of the legwork for today's content. We also have several people in the chat that are co-hosting this, so you can reach out to any of them if you have questions. They are marked as co-hosts, so you can check that out as well. All right, collectively, the Get Savvy team represents organizations across the state of Illinois, which rest on the ancestral lands of multiple Native nations, including the Peoria, Kaskaskia, Piankasha, Wea, Miami, Muskoten, Ottawa, Sauk, Meskwaki, Kickapoo, Potawatomi, and Ojibwe, and Chickasha nations. So today we want to ask you to put in the chat what state and or county you're logging in from today. So we like to get people a little acclimated to the chat since we use it a lot. We don't allow people to unmute themselves just so we can get through the content really quickly. But it looks like people are logging in from Champaign County, Will County, Cook County, DeWitt County, Indiana, New York, not just in Illinois. All kinds of places. Thank you so much for sharing. That's beautiful. Mississippi and Minnesota. That's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for all of our friends across the United States for joining us as well. So today we're going to be exploring kind of the consumer relationships that we have with money online. We're obviously going to be talking about memes. We're also going to discuss the role of fintech or financial technology advancements on consumer choices. We're going to be talking about some of the responsibilities that influencers or content creators on social media have when promoting products or services. And we're going to talk a little bit about digital literacy and how we can use digital literacy to protect our finances or help us make better, more informed decisions. All right, so I'm going to try to launch a poll right now. Let's see. I can find the first one. Whoop. That is a travel poll. Here we go. So I just launched a poll. We want to get an idea. This is an anonymous poll. We want to get an idea of where you typically get information about money. And you can select multiple options here. Is it primarily from family or friends? Maybe from school or government resources? Maybe it's books, the news? Maybe it's specific websites or blogs? There's a lot of financial bloggers out there, for instance. Maybe it's social media or financial professionals or some other source that we haven't mentioned here. Most people are going to probably get their information from a variety of sources. So we'll just wait couple more seconds. It looks like it's leveled out. So we'll end the poll and share the results. It looks like a lot of people currently on the call are getting information from financial professionals, but also from websites and blogs. Quite a bit from family. And quite a bit from social media too, but there's also news and books. So there's a big mix, but it looks like financial professionals and websites is the highest. I'm surprised that family isn't higher based on some of the research around financial socialization, which we'll talk about a little bit later. All right, I am going to talk about our relationships with money and how memes play a role in our relationships with money. So a meme, if you don't know, is just like an image or piece of text, a video, like a snippet of information that's usually humorous in nature that is copied and spread widely. Currently, we refer to it in reference to internet users. But that's not always been the case. For instance, it was first used in a book called The Selfish Gene in 1976 to refer to an idea that gets passed around a lot through a society. So memes have been around for a long time. I think the word meme and how we use it today is relatively new. So when we're talking about memes today, we're talking more about the internet information that gets spread pretty rapidly. So here's some popular remixed memes that you might have seen. You might have heard of Grumpy Cat or Condescending Wonka. You might have heard of Success Kid or Evil Kermit. And these things have been remixed in a variety of ways. Sometimes there's a financial component or a purchasing component. Sometimes there's not. Sometimes it's just in reference to society, what's going on in your life. So if you're thinking about memes and what you've seen in the last, let's say, week, do you think you've seen a meme about money or the economy in the past week? I think I have a poll for this one too. So let me see. All right, I have a poll for that. So I just launched. There's a lot in the news right now about inflation and the economy and generally just how things are going with consumer finances. So I'm not surprised if you did see a meme about the situations. All right, we're leveling things out. So I'll share the results real quick. It looks like 23% of you said yes, 55% said no, and 23% can't remember, which makes sense. There's a lot that's happened in the last week. All right, so I hope I close the poll. All right. All right. So there are memes that are out there that help us kind of communicate our spending desires, like this one with Fry from Futurama saying, "Shut up and take my money." This is an easy, quick response when someone is introduced with a consumer choice and they want to give money for that choice or take advantage of it. So that is one way that we use memes. We also have memes that can describe our complicated relationships with money, or how we feel about a purchase that might be too expensive. For instance, this is the Sweet Brown meme, and someone has modified it to say, "Ain't nobody got money for that." So, which I think we've all felt at some point in our consumer lives. Money memes are usually funny, but they can also spread misinformation. So it's important to be careful when we're sharing them with others. For instance, this is malicious advice mallard, which is a specific type of meme that is designed to share obviously bad advice. But not all memes or content that we see online will be obviously bad. Some can seem plausible, especially if they appear from a reputable source. So we need to be careful about how we're sharing information. So we're going to use the chat, and this is a little bit more complicated of a question, but I want you to think about, what does our reaction to money memes say about how we feel about money? So this is kind of the relationships aspect of money and how we communicate about money. This is a little bit challenging. So if you need a minute to think about it, that makes complete sense. So someone said it could cause someone to feel anxious about money, right? Yeah. Either seeing a meme about money or sharing a meme, someone else might feel anxious about money. And if you're still thinking, think about maybe a money meme you've seen in the past, and what was your reaction to it? Did you think about why you might have that reaction? Could someone else have interpreted it differently than you did? Did you like it or relate to it enough to want to share it with others? All right, well, there's a lot going on in the chat now. We gotta love when there's a meme that is designed about bad financial advice. And the reality is that people see so much bad advice. That is very true. Memes might insert approachable humor around a serious topic. It makes it easier for us to comprehend or talk about sometimes, especially for certain types of money concepts that make people anxious, like debt, for instance. Some people can relate to memes that express being tight or not having enough money and they feel less alone. Absolutely. It can help support community and that feeling of involvedness. A lot about community, it seems like, makes you feel more like a follower to others. It makes me realize that someone else feels the same way that I do. All right. There's a lot of great conversation going on in the chat. We have a lot to cover, so I'm going to keep going, but keep that information going. All right. So we like to talk about money scripts a lot in the Get Savvy webinar series. These are our own cautious beliefs about money, which develop from our financial socialization experiences, like how we're brought up, how our parents talk to us about money or teach us about money, how our friends talk about money, what we're exposed to for experiences throughout our development. All of those things, they typically start in childhood, and our beliefs around money, those money scripts, can change over time based on new information or experiences. And so memes can reinforce some of these beliefs that are sometimes unconscious, so we're not always aware of them at a conscious level, or they can allow us to express these beliefs to others. And the four money scripts that are outlined by research by Ted and Brad Klontz include money avoidance, money worship, money status, and money vigilance. So money avoidance is when people may believe that money is bad and the rich are greedy and undeserving. Money status is when you associate your self-worth with your net worth, and those are equal concepts. Money vigilant is an awareness and attention to financial obligations. People might be nervous about making sure that money is saved for emergencies. Personally, I fall into the money nervous, money vigilant category with a lot of my money scripts. And then money worship is the belief that more money will solve all their problems, and money is happiness and power, and there may never be enough money. And you may have different beliefs that are part of each one of these different money scripts. Like I've very briefly described a whole slew of different financial socialization categories. And we're complicated people, so we might have beliefs that fall in all of them, but you might skew more towards one money script than another. For instance, I probably have ideas related to all of these money scripts, but I definitely lean most towards money vigilance when it comes to my financial socialization. We put in the chat a link to the money scripts inventory if you want to take that and see what you are or learn more about it. But I am going to hand it over to Nikki to talk about some of the fintech advancements.
Hi. All right. So, you know, Andrea kind of laid the groundwork here with how memes and technology have kind of how we can look at how we view that and kind of shows our shows our priorities when it comes to money. So now we're going to kind of take that what's been happening online and go through to talk about some of these different advancements. So the first thing I want to mention is digital assets. There's a timeline on the screen because what it means today is very different than what it started out as. So a digital asset really refers to anything in digital form that has value, can establish ownership, and is discoverable. So when technology first started to kind of become more popular, that really referred to things like photos and videos. Today, it is much more included, it is morphed really into people talking about cryptocurrency, NFTs, security tokens, and more. So the definition has definitely kind of changed with the times. All right, so now we're going to talk about cryptocurrencies. So this is a completely digital currency that represents some value. It changes the value. It's not necessarily the same day to day. Cryptocurrency uses a connected network of computers, and it is not issued by any central authority. They use cryptography to maintain verified records of your transactions with cryptocurrency through this decentralized system. And a lot of people may not realize that there are thousands of different cryptocurrencies that currently exist. There are a lot that people may know of by name because they're in the news, but there are many, many different types or kinds of cryptocurrencies. So I believe Andrea is going to launch this poll. So have you purchased any cryptocurrency in the past 2 years? Answers rolling in. Very interesting answers. All right, it looks like it's slowing down. So go ahead, Andrea. All right. So many people on this webinar have not yet purchased any cryptocurrency. As we're going to get into some stats around different types of crypto and what people are doing. So this is very interesting. So we wanted to show you this graph to kind of show you how cryptocurrency fluctuates. It's very volatile. All right. And this kind of shows from 2014 to about January 10th of this year. So just a couple of days ago. So there's a lot of increase in fluctuation, and it's not exactly predictable that way. So with any technology, any new type of technology, there's new risks, and cryptocurrency definitely has its own as well. And other types of digital assets as well. So first, like that slide kind of shows the popularity and the prices are always up and down. They are always changing. There is a lot of misleading consumer info around these digital assets. Actually, a study in the Wall Street Journal found that nearly 25% of digital coin offerings had disclosure or transparency problems. So, for example, that means like false promises or plagiarized documents. A lot are often non-compliant with applicable rules and regulations, laws. It is also not backed, which means that your money is not guaranteed the way it is when you put it in a bank. So it's not insured. It's not anything that, and for some people, that's, they like that it's coming from this decentralized system, but that does also create new types of risks. So we're going to go briefly through this, a case study to show you kind of how one of these cryptocurrency lenders kind of went from a high to a low, just to demonstrate that fluctuation that we've been talking about. So Voyager Digital is a cryptocurrency lender. At its height, he had 3.5 million customers. It really boomed during the COVID-19 pandemic lockdown, which you'll see, we're going to talk about that a little bit later as well. A lot of these kind of digital assets did have a boom during the lockdown. Voyager actually had a lot of high profile endorsements from people. But in July of 2022, so not even a year ago, they had to pause trading. They had to pause all deposits and all withdrawals. So people could no longer access their assets, and they filed for bankruptcy. In the course of 2022, they lost 98% of its value. And when they filed for bankruptcy, they wanted to find a buyer to take them over. And FTX, another cryptocurrency business, had a deal to buy them for $1.4 billion, but then FTX filed for bankruptcy. The bidding did end up reopening, but customers still cannot get access to any of their assets currently. Binance has now made an offer to buy Voyager. However, the SEC and a lot of state regulators as well have objected to that deal. It looks like it is going to go through. Just a couple of days ago, there was some news about that a judge ruled in their favor, but there are still these objections. But to this day, customers still cannot access their assets. So this is just an example of a cryptocurrency lender and how having a decentralized system and that up and down and that graph kind of demonstrated. We just wanted it to share this case study that's kind of unfolding in real time about this digital asset company. So currently there are no regulations really around any digital assets. So this kind of shows three main points that have happened in this past year. In March, President Biden issued an executive order on ensuring responsible development of digital assets. And that kind of outlined the first ever whole government approach to addressing digital assets risks and potential benefits. Then you guys can see that September 16th, that was when the first reports were released from that EO. And then in between there in May, the US Treasury launched a subgroup of the Financial Literacy and Education Commission to just focus on digital asset education. So this kind of shows the major points that are in that first ever comprehensive framework for the responsible development of digital assets. I will quickly go through this because we still have a lot to go through, but it talks about protections for consumers, investors, and businesses so that people like the SEC or the CFPB can investigate and monitor consumer complaints. Access to safe, affordable financial services, that includes things like instant payment options and improving cross-border payments. Financial stability. So this is the Treasury support financial institutions' ability to kind of lessen cyber attacks. And the Treasury should coordinate with other agencies to identify, track, and analyze risks. And so I'm not going to go through these all just because for time, but I just wanted to give you a few examples that this is the first ever kind of framework for the development of digital assets. And then if this topic specifically interests you about fintech and cryptocurrency, I would encourage you to check out, and I believe it will be in the chat. We have another webinar from fall of 2021, and there are two different podcasts that Andrea and I host on Making Sense of Money that kind of dives more in depth into this. And in February, we are also releasing another very interesting podcast. We had a guest on from the state that kind of is the director of the Office of Innovation, which is dealing a lot with crypto and fintech right now. All right, so now we're going to get into meme stocks. So meme stocks refers to a share of a company that really only gained popularity due to social media and online platforms. If you trace back the history of meme stocks, almost all the articles will agree that the first meme stock was GameStop. You guys can see up in the upper right, it shows how the share went from $2.97 to $483. This was promoted heavily in August of 2020 on a very specific subreddit. It is also true, just like before with crypto, that the COVID-19 pandemic lockdown probably also increased exposure because more people were online, more people were at home. And the stock price ended up rising as much as 100 times what it was over the course of a few months. The social media community really created what's called short squeezes and short selling. If you want to know more about those two things specifically, again, we would want to refer you to our podcast, Making Sense of Money, in episode 14. So these are just a few of the other noteworthy meme stocks that have happened over the past 2 years that you may have seen or know about: AMC, Bed Bath & Beyond, BlackBerry, Nokia. All right, now we're going to talk about Robinhood. Many of you guys may have heard about this user-friendly investor app. And most of these meme stocks were traded using this Robinhood app. Well, what ended up happening was that late January of 2021, so almost exactly a year ago, Robinhood ended up halting the trading of certain securities like GameStop, and then that caused a decline. What happened because of this is congressional hearings and lawsuits ended up creeping up after that halt on the market. June, so 6 months later, FINRA actually fined them $57 million in order to pay $13 million to clients. FINRA, when they looked into them, some of their violations actually went back further than just this halting of the stock market. There were things from even 2016 in their report. And then also in June of 2022, the United House Committee on Financial Services actually called for the SEC to craft new rules because of everything that happened with meme stocks and Robinhood. But those rules have not been crafted yet. And as far as the future of digital assets, it's kind of unclear right now. There, some say that this meme stock craze is already dying down, that, you know, Bed Bath & Beyond, for example, just filed for bankruptcy. However, there's plenty of people who would say the exact opposite, that they anticipate this, that type of meme stock craze will continue. Just within the United States, not the global impact of digital assets, but in the United States, there are new regulations and task force that are being discussed or implemented, researched, not just on the federal level, on the state level, on local levels. And since digital assets are globalized, so the potential regulatory impact could vary very much by country or region. So it's kind of a wait and see. For example, El Salvador actually legalized Bitcoin as a currency, and now holdings are down 60% in 1 year. So that kind of messes with that economy, but it doesn't necessarily have an impact on the U.S. the same exact way as it is in El Salvador currently. And last poll from me for this section, have any of you bought stocks as a result of social media influences?
Got to make this a poll. So if you can put in the chat if you've bought stocks as a result of social media influences, that'd be cool. A lot of no's.
Well, that's...
We have very savvy like consumers.
That. I was going to say very savvy.
One yes.
I know that my husband took his, you know, we each have like our own little pot of money, and he jumped in and wanted to buy some AMC. So I was like, okay, go for it. That's what you want to use your money on, your little bit. So. Yeah.
All right.
I'm going to hand it back over to Andrea, who's going to talk about influencer responsibilities. We did talk a lot earlier in my section about, like, for example, FTX that had a lot of high profile endorsements. So take it away, Andrea.
Thank you so much, Nikki. So like Nikki said, we're going to talk about endorsements a little bit, specifically when it has to do with influencers. So for those of you that don't know, you might have heard of influencers being described as social media personalities or content creators. Usually these are people that have large followings online. They've established themselves as an authority in a particular area and kind of a niche topic area. They may include bloggers or vloggers. They might be on a specific social media channel, but they might be across multiple social media channels. Usually they focus on a particular social channel. So it might be on YouTube or Instagram or TikTok, whatever you're on a lot, you might see them more, for instance. So with these type of content creators, they have influence over consumer spending because they have these large platforms, they have very targeted, specific demographics that they are trying to reach. They can be useful to marketers for endorsement. So we'll talk a little bit about what that means. But before we do that, I have another poll to ask you about. Have you ever been unsure if someone you follow online was trying to sell you something or not? All right, a lot of yeses. A lot of yeses. I'm waiting for it to level out a little bit. It looks like it's leveled out, so we'll end the poll. I'll share the results. 50% of you said yes, you've been unsure if someone you follow online was trying to sell you something or not. 12% of you said no, everyone I've followed has disclosed if their content is an ad. And 38% of you said you don't follow people online. So that definitely limits influencer kind of involvement in consumer decisions. All right. So if you do follow influencers, or if you are an influencer, there are FTC guidelines and tools available to both marketing professionals and influencers to help them navigate how to comply with the FTC Act. Specifically, Section 5 of the FTC Act prohibits deceptive advertising, and it applies to all types of media, not just traditional outlets like newspapers or websites or billboards, for instance. It also applies to social media. So social media sites also have advance their tools that influencers and marketers can use to be more transparent about paid promotions and endorsements, but individual consumers should still be very vigilant. For example, if you're an influencer, one of the guidelines is to not hide that your content is an ad. So consumers should not have to click on your captions to learn that your content is an endorsement. I literally saw like a story or a reel on Instagram yesterday where it was unclear that these people were selling something or they were just talking about something that they bought recently until you scrolled to the very, very bottom of their caption and then it said it was an ad. It did not disclose it with the tools that are available in that social media site where you can kind of like put a alert at the top. It did not disclose it at the very beginning of their caption. And so they were not in compliance with the FTC regulations. Influencers, not just social media marketers, are required to know the requirements of the law. They are required to provide disclosures to their audiences. They are required to be familiar with the endorsement guides on the FTC website, and they are responsible for complying with the law. However, it would be very difficult for the FTC to enforce that act with all of their social media creators, right? So they often go over after companies. However, Kim Kardashian was recently charged by the Securities and Exchange Commission for unlawfully touting crypto security. So Kim Kardashian promoted the Ethereum Max tokens on her social media in June of 2021. But the law, specifically SEC laws, not just the Federal Trade Commission, requires disclosure of the nature, source, and amount of compensation for any crypto security endorsements. So there were two enforcement agencies that she was violating laws for. And so as a result, she was fined $1.26 million in October of 2022. That is an extreme example, but is just to show that just because someone that you might trust or you might think has all of their legal ducks in a row are complying with the law and being transparent about endorsements, that might not be the case. So always do additional research as a consumer to make sure that if you are wanting to make a purchase based on what you've been exposed to online, that you're getting all the information that you need to make an informed decision. All right, so I also want to talk a little bit about the prevalence of fraudulent reviews. So the reports of fake reviews have increased a lot in spring 2020. Obviously, we're buying everything online. And so as a result, there were a lot of fraudsters creating fake reviews, fake negative reviews or positive reviews that influenced consumer spending. In fall of 2021, the FTC actually put hundreds of businesses on notice for these fake reviews and misleading endorsements. So we saw kind of a sharp increase in the number of reports to the Federal Trade Commission around fraudulent reviews, but then we're seeing it kind of go down now thanks to the FTC stepping in and kind of looking at all of these different businesses that were hosting fake reviews to do their due diligence and make sure that consumer transparency is top of mind when it comes to that. All right, so I'm going to hand it back over to Nikki to talk about the growing need for digital financial literacy.
All right, so digital financial literacy, you may have heard either digital literacy or digital financial literacy. They kind of been both used interchangeably. So what are we talking about digital literacy? That actually is, per the American Library Association, it's the ability to use information and communicate. The ability to use communication technologies to find, evaluate, create, and communicate information. This requires both cognitive and technical skills. A lot of this is going to be about how critical thinking, being able to evaluate what you're seeing online or through whatever technology you're using. There's also, if you were to go online and kind of Google digital literacy, you're going to see a very, very large spectrum when people talk about it. Digital literacy can range from everything to how to turn your computer on, all the way to evaluating sources online, right? Like there's this spectrum that you have to kind of narrow down what you're looking for specifically if you want to know more about digital literacy or a topic within digital literacy. Just know there's definitely a spectrum, just like everybody that you probably know, that I know, that there's people who are more comfortable with technology and people who are less comfortable. So kind of depending on what they're exposed to and what they feel comfortable with is that digital literacy spectrum. These are just a few statistics that I found. This was done through Pew Research, and 18% of adults in the US rely on social media for news. 25% of adults could fully identify factual statements, which means 75% of adults could not identify factual statements. And then nearly 40% of US adults admit to accidentally sharing fake news. They didn't realize that they were sharing fake news until after they already shared it. So that kind of just demonstrates how prevalent the problem is. But what most people don't understand is that digital illiteracy actually has a price to it. This was a University of Baltimore study from 2019. And it is the economic cost of fake news. So total, digital illiteracy costs $78 billion. And it was very interesting in this study how it's broken down. Huge amount of stock losses is the number one, $39 billion. financial misinformation, which is what we've been trying to address with the memes and everything during this webinar, is $17 billion. And 63% of Americans say fake news complicates critical financial decisions. That is a huge section of America that is using and counting on what they're reading online or seeing online or being sent. So it's very important to be digitally financial literacy, the growing need for it. There's also public health impacts, elections, brands, and reputation management costs as well. So how do you actually evaluate digital sources? There is a lot of information out there about how to do this, but these six things should definitely help. The first thing is to always review any URLs. Any real news source is going to have very clear websites. There should be no misspelled words. There should be no random endings, right? Like a .alt or something like that. You're also going to want to look at who created the website. So what I mean by that is, where is it coming from? Obviously, things like .org could maybe, you could look and be like, okay, is this a legit organization? .gov is for government, et cetera. Also, look and find the author. So if you're reading something online that you got to randomly through a link on a friend's Instagram page or whatever it might be, do a Google search and or a search of any kind, really, on either the organization or the author that's actually posting the information. Sometimes you'll be surprised to learn that this is just a blogger that has no background in what they're talking about, right? Make sure if it's on a website, read the About Us section. Identify the purpose of the article. Is it too extreme? Is it more opinion than fact? And always, always read past the headline. Don't just take the headline and be like, oh, that must be true. Support. Can you find any sort of support by any other news organizations about that particular story? Are there any known experts that are either referenced in the article you're reading or experts that talk about the same thing that is being discussed in the article? Image verification and statistics. You could always reverse image search, and that will allow you to see the original posting to see where that information first came from. And then always make sure to check the date, make sure you're not reading something that is vastly outdated and no longer relevant. And then ways to improve your digital literacy for finance, three different ways that we're giving you today. One is to continue to improve your financial knowledge. As new financial tools, like we talked about with cryptocurrency, for example, right? As those new types of financial tools, they're going to be created, they're going to be used. So make sure you're keeping up on the basics so you can identify what is real and what is not, or what to look out for. Two, know where to find legitimate sources for financial information. Federal agencies, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, Federal Trading Commission, the SEC, at the state level, my agency, IDFPR, is a good spot as well. The Illinois Attorney General's office has ways, and they have a consumer protection arm as well. So just know where to go if you have questions about your finances. And then the third is to understand your consumer rights and where to go to submit complaints about fraud. You have rights as a consumer, both on the federal level and on the state level. And if you ever need to submit a complaint, there's a link here for the FTC. You could also email me and I will forward complaints along. IDFPR's webpage also has a like complaint area as well. All right, Andrea, you want to go ahead and wrap it up for us?
Yes, so I'll do my best to wrap this up quickly, but touch on all the major components that we wanted to cover for today's webinar. So ultimately, what we've talked about today is that memes are a part of our online culture, that we live both in the real life as well as online. So it's important to be aware of it as a cultural component of our lives. They can add a lot of humor to stressful topics. They can help us feel like we're part of a community, that we're not alone, which is great because humans are social beings and it's very important that we have those feelings of inclusiveness. Sometimes disinformation can be disguised as memes, so we need to be careful about what we're sharing. And it's also important to recognize that how we react to money memes can say a lot about our own feelings about finances or about society in general. When you're thinking about all the different information that we consume throughout the day, especially as it relates to finances, there are many ways that we can try to avoid emotional or reactive decision-making. There are a lot of injustices happening in the world constantly. But Nikki talked a lot about how to make sure that the sources of information that we're receiving are legitimate. But it is sometimes hard to engage in impulse control when we are emotionally reacting to the things that we're seeing. So it's important to know yourself, kind of recognize how your emotions drive your behaviors. Assess kind of how you're feeling. How's your body feeling? Are you excited? Are you nervous? Are you sad? Are you anxious? Are you angry? Maybe you're embarrassed. All of those things can influence our behaviors and how quickly that we respond to things and the nature of our response and whether or not we just click and share or we stop to evaluate the source of our information. Reflecting on your values and your behaviors, both online and offline, can help you identify when you might have difficulties with that impulse control, or you might be more susceptible to confirmation bias where you see a piece of content or a meme that confirms something you already believe rather than looking for what the truth might be or an alternative perspective that might give you more information. You might also want to identify your triggers for spontaneous spending. That's something that we've talked about in the past before as well. So that can definitely help you avoid emotional and reactive decision-making when you're identifying those triggers, when you're identifying your values and what you want to engage in. Something else we've talked about in the past is practicing mindfulness to help you refrain from impulsive purchases or decisions. Like I said earlier, you might reflect on your behaviors during that mindfulness practice as well. You might consider recruiting an accountability buddy to help you maybe avoid jumping to conclusions. Just say, hey, did you see this meme or did you see this article? My friend who doesn't react as quickly as I do, what does it mean or what was your perspective before you share very broadly? So that can also be very helpful. You might redirect your attention to things or activities that help you calm down, make you feel more level-headed before you respond or before you make a purchasing decision. And don't be afraid to ask for help. Like I talked about recruiting an accountability buddy, asking for help on how to do your due diligence or research a topic or a service that you might want to engage in can be very helpful. And knowing when to express yourself and when not to express yourself can also be very helpful for avoiding reactive or emotional decision making. And we've shared some resources in the chat that might be helpful as well. Our next webinar is on February 8th on investing risks and rewards. We're going to be co-hosting that with the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, who we talked a lot and referenced a lot today. So we're very thankful that they are going to be joining us to co-host that particular webinar. You can also watch our previous webinars on YouTube. We will be posting the recording from today's webinar also on YouTube. So you can check those out and you can stay in contact with all of us that facilitate the Get Savvy webinar series as well. We'll put that information in the chat. And we'll stay on for questions, but if you need to go somewhere, if you are very hungry and need to get lunch, don't worry, you can log off. But we will stay on and answer any questions from the chat that we might have missed. And while we're waiting for any questions to pop in for the chat, I did want to specify, like we talked about a lot of different case studies, especially around digital assets. And we don't want to scare anyone away from engaging in new financial technology. We just want to encourage you to do your research. And for instance, when we talked about if you have bought a stock or maybe you've purchased something based on something you've seen on social media, it's not bad. That's not bad. Especially if it's like you see a company doing something that aligns with your values and you want to support them monetarily, you can buy stock, right, in that company to support them. And that's okay. We don't want to discourage that. We just want you to be aware of the endorsement requirements for anyone online promoting a particular service or tool or product. And knowing that you have rights as a consumer and you deserve transparency. All right. So I know we've had lots of people monitoring the chat for us today. Kathy, did you see any questions that Nikki and I should answer?
No, I didn't actually.
Okay.
If somebody has a question, they can put it in the chat right now, though. If I missed it, or, you know, you didn't get a chance to write it before.
We'll stay on for a little bit longer, but if you need to go, that makes a lot of sense. So it's at least in Illinois, it's about lunchtime, or it's past lunchtime for some of us. So, again, this is being recorded. We will put the recording on YouTube. It will also go on the Student Money Management Center website. We will send out, if you registered for this particular webinar, we'll send out the recording and all the materials that Ramya shared in the chat to anyone that registered. So it doesn't look like we have any more questions. Nikki, did you get any privately?
I did not. So hopefully, I know I sort of rambled there a little bit, but hopefully it made sense. And I did just want to stress that Andrew and I have a very good, that webinar coming up, which should be released in about probably like middle of February-ish, that has a special guest on from IDFPR who really specializes in digital assets. So if that part of the presentation was something that you enjoyed, please take a look. Please.
Yeah, that is a podcast, right?
Yes, sorry. It is a podcast. Making Sense of Money is the podcast. You can find it on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, et cetera. So, but Andrew and I definitely, they talk about the FTX and Voyager and all that stuff. So if that part of the webinar definitely interests you, I would make sure to give that a listen.
And we have a lot of content related to digital assets in the whole, all of the episode list for Making Sense of Money. So we shared the links in the chat, but if you wanted to look at it on your own podcast playing platform, Making Sense of Money is found a lot of places. So hopefully that will help you enhance your financial knowledge. All right, so I'm going to wrap up the recording today. Thank you again for staying on and participating. And we really enjoy doing these webinars and having such great engagement. Have a great day.